Welcome into the Middle of Nowhere Gaming Podcast. This is episode 4. I am your host, Courtney Osborne, and today we have the entire team back for the first time in 2 weeks. To my left, we have...
Natty P.
The Notorious Nate, as I said last week. Across me, we have...
Jess, hi.
And...
Hi, I'm Brendan.
Don't steal my thing, bro. Hi. It's trademarked.
It's trademarked. Oh, that's good shit. Okay, before we start, I have to share my fortune with you guys. It says, share your fortune with others. It will bring you good luck. So thank you for listening, and now I have good luck. Hopefully. Well, Monday, whenever you listen to this, I'll have good luck. Whatever. Anything to mention before we get into the news, guys? Anything cool happening? Any exciting stories? Nothing? Nothing good?
I don't think so.
Not absolutely really. Nothing happened.
I don't think so.
To anybody.
Like just in general?
Yeah. Anything cool you want to mention before the news? I got a raise. Yeah. That's cool.
I'm going to Rome next semester.
Going to Rome?
Yeah.
That is awesome. I'm really? Jealous.
Huh? Is that a lie?
No. It's a study abroad program.
Oh.
Yeah. I want to so bad.
Huh.
Anybody want to fund my study abroad trip?
We were just informed we're going to lose a cast member next semester without even realizing it.
It's going to be like a... It's only like a week, so...
Oh, well, when you said next semester and study
sounded
abroad,
like
that sounded
you're gonna
like
be
the
gone
entire
the whole semester.
Semester.
Yeah.
No. Oh, okay.
Actually, I guess something did happen to me. I've been getting into Magic the Gathering recently.
Okay.
My friends are all into it, and so I've finally been, like, coerced into starting to play it.
Nice.
It's, like, really fun, actually.
I've heard it's
I'm
a
really
good
enjoying
game.
It.
Oh, yeah, no,
are you
wait.
Playing... Oh,
just...
sorry.
No, go ahead.
Are you playing the card version or the digital
yeah, just
version?
Just, like, the card version.
Okay, cool.
I'm starting to watch Code Geass, apparently.
Right, pound it.
Brilliant. Need to watch
that. That one's brilliant.
Yeah. I'm not afraid of it, personally. It's like honestly, like, my least favorite anime of all time. It's like, the lowest score I have on, like,
well,
my,
is
like,
is it your least favorite, or is it your most favorite that you dislike?
No, it's definitely, like, my least favorite. Like, I can't think of, like, a
well,
redeemable thing.
There are... Everyone has their own preferences, obviously, because
yeah.
there are, like, people who hate DBZ or Naruto or Bleach,
those people
and
are
then
crazy.
Other people who love them and stuff. So, I mean, it's personal preferences and stuff like that. Anyways, let's move on. Let's go into the news segment, which we need a name for. We should really come up with a cool name, like, you know, Jess's Magical News or...
Well, it wouldn't make sense.
The Unicorn's Brightly, you know, I don't know. Fuck it. All right. According to... a news report this week. The Xbox One will record all of your achievements. So I guess there's going to be like a running recording going on all the time, like the last 5 minutes or something. And every time you unlock an achievement, it will be saved to view or share later. So like the last few seconds or whatever it was that you did in order to get that achievement, it'll be saved. What do you guys think? That's kind of cool to me.
Well, I guess you can't really make achievement guide videos anymore.
No, that's true. But, well, I mean, it makes it easier to make them, right?
Yeah, you could.
Yeah.
Because then you could post them for everyone to see.
It's like they're going to flood the market. Each
that's
video
true.
Will be less valuable.
But there'll still be the people like achievement hunters or whatever who will have a reliable base already that people will want to go to. Because they'll probably have commentary and stuff like that. You know, this is how we did it. This is what we did. Rather than just a 10-second video of unlocking it.
Yeah, and like honestly, like I've never really been too like... huge in achievements myself.
You're not an achievement whore?
Like, I don't know, I just don't see the point, because, like, the numbers are completely arbitrary.
Yeah.
So, like, I've, like, it's cool when I get them. Like, I'm like, oh, yay, yeah. But, like, I don't really care that much about, like, trying to get them.
Are you guys achievement whores or trophy whores or whatever?
No, not me, because, like, I don't know, I like it when I get them, like Nate, but I just, I don't know, I like looking at the name of the achievement, because it's usually pretty creative.
What, you, Brendan?
I got into it, like, this summer, and I, finally... actually worked on some games for him, but then after like one achievement was kind of bugged, I just kind of rage quit the entire system.
Oh yeah, there are games that are like that. You'll come to learn that I'm an achievement and trophy whore. I try to get as many as possible, but some games I decide beforehand, I'm like, there's no way I'm getting these. Like the ones where it's like, play it on every difficulty, play it on super hard mode, you have to play it on hard mode first, and then unlock super hard mode, and then play it on
like
super
on
hard
some
mode.
Some of those arcade games?
Yeah, it's not Lord. Fucking happening. next news. Rockstar has released a Grand Theft Auto 5 online deleted character fix.
I have been playing Grand Theft Auto Online. It's pretty cool.
I hear...
Talk louder.
I've actually heard that like the GTA Online problems have been like really, really bad.
I heard
it's
breaking the game.
Yeah, like a lot of people just cannot play it and they're just losing their progress randomly.
lots of crashes, lots of stuff like that. Apparently, some people are even losing their single-player saves.
Yeah.
All the time.
That's crazy. Yeah, that hasn't happened to me yet.
Go on.
I feel like they probably needed to, like, make sure they had enough, like, infrastructure in place before they really started to do this, because...
Yeah.
I mean, GTA sold a lot of copies.
To let you guys in on this, it's released on PlayStation 3 right now, which is Thursday, and then it'll be on Xbox 360 tomorrow, which is Friday, so it'll already be out for everybody. So in case you're having this problem, go and get this fixed. Also, this is only fixing the character deletion, and it's not fixing the vehicle deletion, so anybody who's having their vehicles disappear from the garages, it's not going to make a difference. That's not going to fix that. And Rockstar is also reiterating its advice to exit Grand Theft Auto Online by returning to single player in order to force a save. Do not select retry or create a temporary character when confronted with the message saying that the Rockstar Cloud servers are down. So, don't fuck it up.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see. The reports are that the PlayStation 4 camera was removed from the bundle due to its price. Honestly, I've known this for months. This, like, the second it was announced, I knew that that was why it didn't have a camera. I don't know if you guys watched E3 or not, watched all the press conferences, but, like, Microsoft had their press conference early, and they said, you know, we have Kinect included, and it's going to be $500. And then Sony came out, and they're like, we don't have the camera, and ours is $400. Everyone is like, okay, they took it out in order to beat Microsoft's price point. So it makes a lot of sense.
I mean, was anybody going to use the camera much anyway?
See, and that's the argument that's being made, is how much is it going to be used? Because, like, having the camera in it is making the camera get into more people's hands, which then means developers can develop games that use the camera. But if they don't have it in their hands, then developers aren't going to want to make any games with cameras. It's just less likely that it'll happen. And in the Xbox's case, then since the Kinect is going to be in everybody's hands, everybody who gets an Xbox One, that means developers can develop with the camera in mind.
Personally, I'm glad there's less of a chance for camera games. They always feel way too gimmicky, in my opinion.
I completely agree. I never liked them. Have you guys played any camera games for any of them?
Yeah.
Any new consoles?
Yeah, I have. It's just, I feel like the games, like, when they are made for the camera, they try too hard to include the camera action into it, and so it kind of kills the gameplay a little bit, especially when you do it and it doesn't work, so you're mad, you don't want to play it anymore.
I only play those games when, like, my little cousins are over and I can't play M-rated games in front of them.
Yeah.
So. Oh, boo.
I guess the only real thing of interest to talk about on this, though, is that the PlayStation 4 is allegedly selling for $60 loss per unit due to not having the camera in the package, which, I mean, hurts them initially, but with the sheer amount of consoles they're going to sell, eventually they're going to make up and start making profit, and it's going to be much faster rather than having it $500.
Yeah, like, Sony wouldn't make a decision like that if they weren't sure that they could make back the margins.
Exactly.
Maybe that's a marketing ploy to get a bunch of Xbox fanboys to buy as many PS4s as they can. Like, this is going to hurt Sony so much.
Exactly. I completely agree. Because I already know some Xbox fans who are starting to be swayed in the direction towards PlayStation. They were originally also, but there are more now that are like, you know, the $100 and not having a camera seems kind of good, especially when there's not very many exclusive titles on either console right now, when you can get a lot of the games on both, like Assassin's Creed or Watch Dogs or NBA or Madden.
And Destiny. Woohoo.
Destiny eventually next year also, yep. The Russian government has decided to develop video games.
Can we have, like, serious talk hour here real quick?
Yeah.
Like,
hit us with it.
Russia's getting, like, I mean, don't get me wrong, like, the USA has totally been, like, super nationalist and, like, imperialist and, like, it's propaganda and rhetoric, like, forever. Like, that's not a new thing. But, like, Russia's getting, like, very scarily nationalist these days. Like, Putin, I don't know if you guys knew this, but, like, Putin had, like a parade on, like, Stalin's birthday, like, celebrating, like, the heroism of, like, the Soviet Union, and it's kind of, I don't know.
Didn't he also, like, win an election by 130%?
I don't remember. It seems like that's probably not true, but
I have never heard that
face,
before. That's
yeah.
like
they,
it is
they
super
like,
corrupt,
fixed
though.
It, and they fixed, like, the election, but they miscalculated.
Well, I wouldn't doubt it. I mean, that's...
It's highly believed Putin won
through,
like...
wrong.
Corruption, though.
Well, his a little bit of my history major background. When Kansas was becoming a state or whatever, they were electing the governor, whatever, senator or something like that, and there were supposed to be, let's say, 4,000 or 5,000 people living in Kansas at the time, but there was like 15,000 votes cast, and it was because people from Missouri and Nebraska and everywhere came down into Kansas, you know, and they all cast votes. So it's like something like that. That's what it reminds me of, even though that's not right at all. But anyways, the Russian government, they say they will develop patriotic video games and could ban foreign video games that distort history. That's about every gun game ever.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know if you guys... Did you guys play, what was it, Modern Warfare 2?
Yeah.
Where you have to be the Russian, I don't know, was it Mafia or something? Where you go through that mall or
the airport and
you're
just, and you just kill everyone.
Destroying all the civilians.
I thought that was right out of the history books, though.
That happened, didn't it? I've learned history wrong! The Russian Military History Society will be in charge of the project, and they say they feel like the Russian warrior has been portrayed wrongly in past games such as Company of Heroes 2. I didn't play that game.
I mean, I thought Viktor Reznov was pretty idealistic.
Reznov? Was that Call of Duty also?
As Black Ops.
Yeah. Ah, see. Yeah, I remember that one. Was that the one where he was alternate, or he wasn't really there?
Yeah.
Spoiler, sorry.
Yeah.
Oh, it's been out for, like, 3 years now.
I know, guys, but still.
But, yeah, like, I never played Company of Heroes, but I hear that, like, they kind of portray the Russians somewhat stereotypically, if I remember correctly.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Next on the list is Wolf Among Us has a release date, and it's coming out Friday, October 11th, which is tomorrow for us, and it's last Friday for you guys. It is a game from Telltale Games, the makers of the Walking Dead video game last year, which won Game of the Year.
Mm-hmm.
And it's going to be episodic, and it's based on Bill Willingham's Fables comic book series, which are an alternate version of all the classic fairy tales, like The Three Little Pigs and all that other nonsense. But I don't know, that sounds badass to me.
Yeah, like, I actually didn't hear about this until, like, right now, but, like, I've actually heard of both of the people, like, Telltale Games and the Fables series, like, separately, and mm-hmm. so it actually seems really interesting.
Well, do you guys know about the Fable series? The Fables
no.
series? Brendan?
No, I do not.
Just a little bit of background on it. It's like the original classic fairy tales, like what I was just saying. Or The Little Mermaid also. That's another one. There's a lot of them that all ended up being made into Disney films and things like that. But this original version, it's like gory, hardcore, like M-rated stuff. Like, shit happens. Like, The Little Mermaid gets legs or whatever and then can't breathe and dies or something, like some crazy stuff. Like, none of them have good endings.
Every single, like, Disney story is completely horrible.
Yeah, they really,
like,
are.
Victor Hugo's Hunchback of Notre Dame.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone dies.
Yep.
In horrible ways.
But this game it's going to be played a lot like The Walking Dead. It's going to have the same kind of gameplay. And it's going to be, I believe, set in modern times. It's a take on the original comic series. And, But it's modern based, and so they're gonna change everything. And I guess I think you're the big bad wolf. I think you're like a sheriff or something, and that's who your playable character is. So that's pretty cool. And like every decision you make in the game changes how it ends up. So like there's a lot of branches you can take by different things you say and things you do. Different people can die.
Mm-hmm.
It sounds cool.
And the cool thing about it is that they really try to stay away from like morally like dogmatic, like video games. There's a lot of games where you have like really like bland, like obvious moral choices, like in Bioshock 2, where they're just like, you can either kill this innocent person or let them live. And
I
wonder which one's the right choice.
I love that because I'm like, horrible at those decisions, like mm-hmm. that are gray area.
Yeah.
And so like the one that, and like they don't reward you like in how some games do for like choosing the right path or like punishing you later on for mm-hmm. choosing the wrong one. It's you'll get punished or like helped regardless of your choices. Like,
oh yeah, and it doesn't matter if it, say like this game or The Walking Dead, is if you choose a good thing, somebody's still gonna die. Mm-hmm. You know, and it may not be the person you expected, because in The Walking Dead last season, there was like episode 2 or 3 where there's this chick who I had the hots for in the game. You know, I'm like, dude, I am totally gonna get with that girl. And so I started like focusing more on her, and she ended up getting killed by this other psycho bitch who liked me. It was like, how does that happen? I did everything for this girl, and something else in the story just wasted her. And so, like, that kind of stuff can happen in these
clearly
games.
You made the other girl jealous.
I know, right? I regretted it. I almost cried.
You're such a chick, man.
I know. Fuck it. Another news, Far Cry 4 is reported to be in development. Did you guys play Far Cry 3?
Not yet.
Not yet.
It was alright.
I loved it. It was fun. It was really fun. It's basically, you know, letting you out into islands and telling you, you know, follow the basic story, but also go and kill shit, kill animals, kill sharks, and take over outposts, which was fun to take over outposts.
The thing about Far Cry 3 that always got to me is that they tried, like, really hard to make me care about, like, this bland, like, white dude's, like, personal backstory, and yeah, the whole time I just did not care at all.
We'll see, and it's probably based on people's personalities and things like that. It's probably trying to make you relate to it if you're that kind of, you know, hot, middle upper class kid who's getting college paid for and all that stuff, and then that's probably a lot of kids that play that game probably are like that, you know.
Screw those people, by the way.
Yeah, fuck you guys.
Yeah, I hate white people.
Yeah, fuck that. I was gonna say I hate.
By the way,
middle upper class.
White. I don't actually hate white people.
I'm lower class. We suck.
What does you being white have to do with you not hating white people with?
What I can hate white
I
people.
I hate certain white people.
Yeah, I definitely hate certain white people. Okay, we should get off the
and
race
I hate
topic,
everyone.
Though.
Jess.
Resolved.
So, religion and politics.
Yeah, there we go. That's less controversial. Controversy. I can't speak.
Boo.
Anyways, composer Cliff Martinez, known for working on the game Drive. Oh, wait, that's a movie, isn't it? Not a game. Is it a movie?
That's
Drive.
A movie.
Yeah, the movie Drive. I miswrote that. He worked on the game, movie Drive. He stated in an interview with Lost in the Multiplex that he is working on a video game called Far Cry 4.
He also drummed for the Red Hot Chili Peppers for a while.
Oh, really?
Yes.
That's weird.
And
that's
he
cool,
also
though.
Was, I don't know if you guys have ever heard of Captain Beefheart, but he also worked with them for a long time.
Captain Beefheart? Who's
yeah.
that?
He was like a blues musician in the 70s. There was Captain Beefheart and his magic band, and they're actually pretty good.
So was it Beefheart or Beefheart?
Beef heart, like beef, like, and then heart, like a
heart.
Human heart, yeah.
Not as cool.
Yeah, okay. I agree. Anyways, well, that game should be cool. It's going to be on next gen, obviously, if it's just now being developed. Other news, the DualShock 4 will be compatible with the PC at launch. Shuhei Yoshida was quoted saying it will have basic functions, and this is different from the PlayStation 3 controller because the PlayStation 3 controller required third-party software in order to work fully function on the PC.
I mean, the problem is that, like, since it's probably not going to be, like, native, you're still going to have to use, like, Joyticky or something.
Yeah, quite possibly. And there's going to be functions of the PlayStation 4 controller that can't be used on the PC, like the touchscreen and the light bar and things like that, that'll probably won't be able to be used right away, but maybe sometime in the future there can be a third-party software that'll integrate it somehow. But right now, there's no way it's going to be used. Are you guys interested in using a PS4 controller on a computer? Have you ever used any controller on a computer?
Nope.
No.
I have.
I have, too.
Because I never had PC strong enough to do,
that's
like,
true.
Yeah, same
gaming.
Here.
Well, so. You guys just get an emulator and run some old games.
Well, that's illegal.
Oh, so. Sorry, we don't recommend you guys do that. Even though Brendan
does.
Let's
be honest, though.
No, I don't.
Yeah. What?
Let's be honest here, though. Like, we've all done it.
No.
I can't say
I have.
Like,
you guys are all dirtbags.
No, there's a rule, I think, or a law that says you have to have it deleted within 7 days or 30 days or something like that.
No,
isn't there?
I check Nintendo's like legal site. It's just illegal all the time.
Well, that's for Nintendo. But I swore there was a thing that, like, on the ROM or emulator sites that always used to say, you know, you can have this file, but you have to have it deleted from your system within so long. And it wasn't a very long amount of time.
Those emulator sites, they lie.
Oh, well, I'm sure they do, yeah. But still. But it's a way to cover their ass in case they get, you know.
I wouldn't trust illegal sites on legal advice.
I would. I trust anything on the internet because,
I mean,
it's
like,
all true.
If it's really about, like, getting caught, like, there's, like, zero chance of you getting caught. Nintendo, first of all, just doesn't have the infrastructure, and the FBI doesn't really give a shit, so, like,
well, yeah, and Nintendo's not based in America anyways, so yeah. It's like, why would they target people over here for something small, like downloading Pokemon Red?
Yeah,
you
like,
know?
Like, Nintendo of America could theoretically, like, try and sue John Doe IPs, but, like, that never works out well, and, like, it'll just make them look really bad. It'll be terrible PR. Because, like, with the RIA, let's not encourage
though, use of ROMs.
Yeah, we're not encouraging everybody to just go download 1,000 of them. But,
I'm saying is that I did have a flash cart for my DS, and I did do it.
Use your own judgment, listeners. Use your own judgment.
Use the good judgment, too.
Use the Force. These are not the droids you're looking for. All right, let's move on to our topics. Who wants to start this week? Anybody want to start?
It's not matter.
Don't everybody jump up and scream at once. All right, let's start with Jess. Jess, what's your topic this week?
My topic has to do with the Game of the Year predictions, and I decided to do this topic mostly because I saw on very many different sources that everyone thinks it's going to be between The Last of Us and all of a sudden Grand Theft Auto V, and I know that everyone has really mixed opinions on this, so I thought it'd be interesting to talk about on the podcast.
Okay, do you want to start with you, or do you want us to go?
You guys go.
Okay, let's go, Brendan. What do you think?
I've got to say probably just with the popularity, GTA V.
Okay. Why? Just because of its popularity, or?
Yeah, I mean, it's a really good game. I mean, it's pretty good, like, social, like, satire.
Mm-hmm. I have to ask, who ranks, like, Game of the Year? Is there, like, some, like, objective rating board that, like, gives the best picture?
No, it's the Game of the Year. Every different website, every different publisher does it.
Oh, well, they're paid hacks anyway.
And they do, yeah, they have their own, they normally have nominations or whatever, and then they go through the office and they ask everybody, and that's how they come up with it. It doesn't have to be specific console, doesn't have to be specific genre, because, like, last year, almost everywhere elected The Walking Dead. And they elected that over some other big name titles, and it was just how did that happen?
Journey win a bunch.
Yep, Journey won it the year before, and it's like, you know, and they beat out games like Halo 4. And I'm not saying Halo 4 is great; they beat out games like that, Mass Effect 3, and stuff like that. When you could beat The Walking Dead in less than 10 hours, beat the 5 episodes. It's just like,
well,
you know.
No, that's kind of an understatement. They're long.
The Walking Dead.
Yeah,
I beat every episode in almost 2.5 hours, so it was just a little over 10.
Well, it took me like a few days.
Really?
Yeah.
Huh. Each episode was like 2.5-3 hours at max if you just played it through.
Do you even play?
I guess I'm slow.
Yeah, well, some people do. Like, I have a buddy who, every game I've played, like, say, Assassin's Creed 3, I beat it in 50 hours, and his was closer to, like, 80 or 90 hours. He just takes more time than me on everything, and it's because I tend to speed through some things, so.
Brendan, what do you want the Game of the Year to be? Like, what do you think it should be?
If you had to cast a vote.
Well, I've played one game that's been released this year, and that's GTA 5, and I haven't even been able to play, like, for more than 2 hours, so, yeah, I'm bummed for that.
Okay. Nate, you want to go? What are your predictions? What do you think people are going to pick, and what would you pick?
I think people are going to pick Bioshock Infinite or The Last of Us.
Okay.
I would pick, like, nothing, honestly.
Come on, pick
I mean,
something.
Like, honestly, dead serious though. Like, well, I nothing know, really stands out to me as being like.
I know you have a thing for older games, and you don't.
No,
think
that's not true.
Games compare to. Older
I totally
games.
Agree with like The Walking Dead being the Game of the Year. Yeah, thing. Like that was a great game. I just don't like people like make up the stories and like the plots and Bioshock Infinite to be a lot more deep than they really are, but they're not.
Well, here's what I'm saying is. In the year 2013, you have so many games that are released. If you had to pick one to be better than the other ones of just this year, never comparing anything else, what do you think is it? I mean, like, you only have so many games. You can even pick Gone Home. Did you think it was more, if it was better than Bioshock?
Yeah, like, I really do love Gone Home, but, like, I can't really say that, like, it's really deserving a Game of the Year, because, like, I don't know, there's just not a bunch of, like, it's not enough of a game, if that makes sense for me. And that's really, like, you know, descriptivist way for me to describe it, but like I don't know.
We're not all saying that it's not a game. That's Nate saying it.
Like, I loved it though. It's one I really enjoyed it, but like, I don't know. I guess I would probably have to go with GTA 5.
Okay.
Like, it's not perfect, but I definitely say it's better than like the other nominees. Maybe like it's kind of a cop out, but I guess I could say Dota 2. But
What is Dota 2 exactly? What is?
It's basically like,
what's it stand for?
Defense of the Ancients.
Okay.
And it's basically like a five-man... Like, imagine... It plays similar to, like, how, like, PvP does in, like, MMOs, okay. Where it's, like, you control, like, characters, like, skills and stuff. But they're, like, it's, like, a top-down, and it's, like, kind of like an RTS mixed with, like, a fighting game.
Okay. Huh. Interesting. And it's computer, I'm assuming, right?
Yes.
Okay.
And you have to use a mouse.
Cool.
The original had a song by Bass Hunter named after it.
Really?
Yeah. Dota.
Dota. I guess I don't understand.
Oh, okay.
I'm behind on the times, I suppose.
It was like years ago, so.
Okay. Well, if I had to pick a game of the year, like you guys have kind of mentioned and almost scoffed at, but I would have to pick The Last of Us or Bioshock Infinite. And but with honorable mention, I would say Ni No Kuni. Ni No Kuni was way better than people expected
it to
be.
Is that the game? It sounds like a... It's a JRPG. I think I've seen this, actually. I saw it on, like, the CVG thing. This one, yes.
Ni No Kuni, yeah.
I've heard of this.
I didn't hear about this
until, like, monsters. 3 days ago. But I was super interested in it as soon as I heard about it. But it I don't have a PS3,
really,
so.
Really, really good. It blew people away. All the people who don't like JRPGs or whatever, on all the big major websites, when they played it and reviewed it, everyone was stunned at how good it was. Because it's Studio Ghibli and Level 5 together, working together on this game. And it's awesome. It's a touching story, you know, a little boy and trying to save his mom. And he can it's kind of like Pokemon in the fact that you can catch and train little monsters and stuff. But the story is way deeper. And it's a kick-ass battle system, and it's a fun world. But like I said, that would probably be honorable mention. If I had to choose one, it would be The Last of Us. I've never played in a game that impacted me more than The Last of Us had, or did. I've played it twice, which is saying something, because I don't play a game twice if within the same year, or within the same 3 months of release, or within 3 months of its release, like I did with that game. It's amazing. And I also, if I had to pick one that everyone else is going to choose... I think it's going to go down between The Last of Us and Grand Theft Auto V. Because The Last of Us, because everyone agrees with me, all the major publishers, and Grand Theft Auto, because it's the most recent. By the time they start voting for it, it'll still be in everyone's minds. And that's why I think Grand Theft Auto may beat The Last of Us by the time it comes around in December. What about you, Jess? You started us off.
Oh, yeah. I think my decision would probably be between Bioshock Infinite and... Grand Theft Auto V, because Grand Theft Auto V was just a fun game to play. It's like one of those games where you can just play it for hours without even touching the storyline. Mm-hmm. Most people don't play it for the storyline anyway. So, in all honesty, I think that game is just a lot of fun. Bioshock Infinite and The Last of Us were really impactful games, whether that be negative or positive. Because I've heard a lot of people will be afraid. Like, they're like, they don't like being like scared by games. And so The Last of Us was really... impactful in that way, and emotional as well. So I would pick Grand Theft Auto V because I just love playing it, just like, I don't know, I just do. And I think that people will pick The Last of Us just because of its overall compared to Grand Theft Auto V. So yeah.
Fair enough. Alright, that wraps up Jess's topic. Let's move on to one of the three remaining topics. Who wants to go next? Again, everybody is so excited to speak on their topic. We'll go with Brendan. Brendan, what is your topic, big dog?
So, in honor of Pokemon X and Y, you guys have all played Pokemon games, right?
Yep.
Nope, I'm almost not every in one this of
them.
One.
I played every one.
Okay, well, what are you guys' favorites?
Pokemon's the Silver and Gold generation, I think, is still the best.
Fucking right. Oh, God.
Actually, I agree with
because
that.
Really?
Because what happened is that, like, Pokemon Silver was, like, a direct improvement over the things that the original game really did, right? Yep. And it was the last game where Pokemon really innovated on its, like, concepts.
Until now.
Yeah, right, and yeah. X and Y looks interesting. Like, I haven't really looked too much into it because I don't have a 3DS, but, like, as the games that are released right now, it's definitely the best.
If I had to choose one, I would definitely say Pokemon Silver and Gold. I played Yellow and Blue on the first gen, you know? And I loved them, and then when Silver came out, I saw Ho-Oh and Lugia, and I was just like, oh my god, those things look so cool. And then I started watching, whatever the second series was called, with Totodile and all them at the beginning. But yeah, so I got Silver, my brother got Gold, and I beat it like 4 times. I played the crap out of it. I loved the fact that you could visit both the new region and the old region during that game.
Yeah, that's the reason it's my favorite. For the game,
because you could visit the old one also.
Yeah,
that
it's like twice the fun.
Yeah, exactly. It was like playing the game twice, or playing the original game inside the new game. Oh god, it was brilliant.
I mean, like, there's some faults to it. Like, it's still too easy, which is my big problem with all the Pokemon.
Well, it's
games.
Easy, but it takes a long time.
Training,
if you want to like get all of your Pokemon to be extremely competent.
I mean, Pokemon games are catered towards the younger kids, so it's not like it was meant to be super hard, and there is no difficulty scale. But if there was a difficulty scale, I mean, like, how much harder can you make it? The only things you could really add to would be to where trainers, you know, wouldn't let you hit them with super effective elemental moves. You know, like, if it was a water Pokemon and you're fighting with electric or whatever, they would end up, you know, doing something to switch it out, which didn't... They really haven't taken advantage of that in many of the games.
Yeah. I know the boss battle AI for, like, Black and White and Black and White 2 were really improved, though. They actually do a lot of things like that, and they have good tactics.
You said doo-doo.
Doo-doo. I think I played, like, half of Black, but I don't think I ever beat it.
Yeah. And, like, it's still just... Like, the AI kind of sucks, and it's too easy. I hope they implement... I think they did implement some sort of, like, actual, like, in-game, like, Nuzlocke run kind of thing in Black and White 2.
Mm-hmm.
Can't remember if that's true or not. Don't know if they're doing it for X and Y, but I hope they do for whichever one they do, because that would actually make the game a lot harder for me.
Okay.
For some Pokemon games, I've gone to, like, the last gym, and I, like, fight the gym leader to see, like, how powerful his Pokemon are.
Mm-hmm.
And then I look around, go outside, train, and I see how little XP the, like, other Pokemon give me, and I just quit, because it'll take, like, 4 hours of
I don't really just, like, go back and find places to train, or go into, like, the caves or whatever and train, and then, like, when I make it to the Final Four, or the Elite Four, or whatever they're all called, I would fight my way through, because I wouldn't be strong enough to fight my way all the way to the end the first time. So I'd just sit there and fight the first trainer over and over and over, leveling up. Then I'd fight the second one over and over and just keep making it the first two trainers in, getting more and more experience until I could finally beat them all. And then I would just go back through and beat the four over and over and over just to keep training.
Well, that's what I did. Like, for my first run through of, like, Yellow, I just use like Staryu in, like, Misty Gym, because it just gave you a crap ton of experience, so I got really pissed when I finally beat it.
Staryu.
Because I really wanted the experience.
Cool. And you said you haven't played any games, Jess? Mm-mm. Any of those games?
Mm-mm.
You should check them out. They're good stuff. Maybe you should not illegally get an emulator and a ROM of the old games and play them. I said not, okay. By the way, people. Alright, I think we wrapped that one up. Nate, do you want to go next on yours, or do you want me to go?
I can go mine if you want.
Okay. What's your topic?
Well, I started playing Final Fantasy VI, finally, after, like, putting it off for, like, probably about 3 years at this point.
And as in, you've played it before and then put it off, or you were playing it for the first time?
I've never played it before. Okay. This is my first Final Fantasy game.
Okay.
Although I've seen people play, like, 7 and 9 before. Okay. And, like, I don't know how many of you guys have played Final Fantasy. I assume he's played
a bunch.
But I really like Final Fantasy VI a lot more than I was, like, expecting to, coming off of, like, watching 7 and 9, which looked kind of, I don't know. I don't want to say gay, because that's, like, offensive, but, like, seven not my style. Overrated. But, like, I don't know. It's really interesting, honestly. It's not, like, grown up or anything, but it's not, like, too easy. It's just fun.
I've heard Final Fantasy VI is regarded as, like, the best of the Final Fantasy games. So, I don't know if you guys have heard anything, because, like... Like, newer generations will all say 7 is the best, but if you talk to the people who played the original games, they all agree that 6 is amazing. And so it's one of those games that I've always wanted to play. Isn't it, like, 2D, like, 16-bit characters or something like that?
Yeah, and it has, like, some, like, pseudo-3D things where, like, you're, like, on the Chocobo and you, like, go around, like, a sprite map. And, like, it's not too, like... They do a lot with what the hardware had at the time. Like,
yeah.
They really pushed the envelope.
Because it was Super Nintendo originally, wasn't it? Yeah, that's what I thought. It's an old game. And then I think they brought it over to PlayStation 1 eventually, and then I think now it's on PlayStation Network for anybody to download also.
I'm actually playing the GBA remake.
Okay.
Because they changed the translation and, like, edit. Because, like, the SNES version, they, like, had to, like, whitewash tons of nudity and, like, stuff and, like, like, bad scenes out of it. And then in the GBA one, they, like, released some of the whitewashing. Oh. So I was like, okay, I'll play that one.
Interesting. Brandon, you haven't played any Final Fantasies, right?
Nope.
And Jess, you're just now playing your first one, and it's 13?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Okay, you're entering in the same way I did. I entered in with 13 also. I haven't played 1 through 12 yet, so... I don't know how many of those are. I've started 7, I've started 8, but I've never beaten them. I thought they were okay. They didn't blow me away, but it's part of the fact that I'm not very good at playing old games anymore. If I had played them when they came out, I probably would have loved them. But now it's so hard to play them. And so I started with 13 and 13-2, And I absolutely love those games. Those games are so much fun. But and that's just me being entering in late. So I know all the older Final Fantasy fans don't like those. Don't like 13 and 13-2. You haven't played those, right?
No, I haven't. Yeah. I didn't own a PS3, so I couldn't.
Well, they're on Xbox also.
They were?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yep. They're good. They're good games. You should definitely give them a shot someday. They're not going to be comparable to 6, obviously, or 7, or 8, or 9, because they're different, but they're good games in themselves. If you look at them as a different game, if you don't look at them as, you know, like, Final Fantasy, it has to be the same way every single time. If you look at them as its own special game, then it's cool. So, now, what are you asking us exactly on this? Like,
oh, well, I was going to just basically ask, like, what were you guys' opinions on, like, the old versus new divide, but in hindsight, I mean, I guess really, like, only me and you have enough of an opinion on it.
Yes, if I had to choose, I would say new, but there's a plethora of old games in the series, so I'm sure there are some really good ones if we went back to play them all.
I hear 4 is all right, too. I
haven't gotten around to it. I've heard that, too. I've heard 4 and 6 are awesome, and then people say 7 is good, and then 9 is good.
Mm-hmm.
Skipped 8. I heard there's too much emo in it.
But... yeah.
But then I'm going to play 10 and 10-2 whenever it gets re-released in HD later this year or early next year. So I'll be able to see how those are. But, whatever. All right, is that enough on that? Since you guys don't really have much to say on Final Fantasy.
That's right. Sorry. It's no, okay. It's cool. No,
we don't have to always have to everybody talk on every single thing. So, and mine, my topic is more going to be more about me blabbering stuff because somebody asked me to. So if you guys want to chime in on something, feel free to. But Joe asked me, one of my buddies, a few weeks ago, if I would explain the differences between the PlayStation 3 and the PlayStation 4, because he's been thinking about getting a PlayStation 4 and he's not a huge gamer, so he doesn't know all the differences. You know, like anybody could be like, okay, well, it's probably better, but you know, how much better is it? So I came up with a list of things to talk about the differences. All right, now you're going to have to follow me on some of these terms. I'm going to try to explain them, but the CPU for the PlayStation 3 was a cell broadband engine. The PlayStation 4 has an AMD Jaguar 64-bit, which is 9 times faster than the PlayStation 3. So that's all you need to remember from that. The CPU is 9 times faster. The memory for the PlayStation 3 was a 256 megabyte RAM. The PlayStation 4 is an 8 gigabyte RAM, which is, God, how many times faster is that? That's a lot faster, like significantly faster.
That's more than twice as fast.
Just to be like the correcting like geek guy.
Well, there's exponential.
More RAM doesn't necessarily mean it's faster. Yeah. It just means it has the potential to
be faster. And it can run more programs at the same time, things like that, which then is where it becomes faster, is because you can run them all at the same time and then still keep their speeds.
Mm-hmm. So if the CPU is good enough, then the RAM increases.
Yes. The hard drive for the PlayStation 3 is built in, but it has varying sizes, so you can buy different sizes, and it's interchangeable and upgradable. The PlayStation 4, the hard drive that comes with it, is 500 gigabytes, and it is also interchangeable and upgradable. So if you wanted a bigger hard drive, you can get one. The output for the PlayStation 3, you can have an HDMI or analog or digital output. For the PlayStation 4, it's the same exact way. For USB drives, the PlayStation 3 had 2 USB 2.0s. The PlayStation 4 has 3 USB 3.0s and an auxiliary output. So they have those two, which are better. For wireless internet, the PS3 had Wi-Fi, and the PlayStation 4 has Wi-Fi and also Bluetooth through iPhone and iPads. So that's cool.
Which is totally insecure, though.
Isn't it like tethering or something like that, where you run the internet through those? Like,
yeah.
Bluetooth
is a super insecure protocol, though.
Oh, yeah. I agree. But, I mean, it's still an option if you don't have Wi-Fi at the time, if you need to run something to maybe get a download or not play online, obviously.
Now, that's for the Xbox.
This is for PlayStation 4.
The PS4 is the Bluetooth one?
Yes, it has it.
Is the PS4 allowing, like, the Linux-based stuff?
I don't think so, but I don't know. I know they didn't, or they did originally on PlayStation 3 and then didn't, but I don't know about
if that
this.
Was the case, then that could be actually like a pretty big security risk.
But. Yeah, probably not. They probably learned after PlayStation 3 had problems. For media, on the PlayStation 3, you can run Blu-ray discs and you can run media off your hard drive. On the PlayStation 4, you can run Blu-ray discs at 6 times the speed of the PlayStation 3, and you can run games off your hard drive also. The controller for the PlayStation 3 is a DualShock 3 with 6-axis motion sensing, which is just a PlayStation 3 controller. The controller for the PlayStation 4 is a DualShock 4 with 6-axis motion sensing and a 2-point touchpad, which is a touchpad on top of the controller. There is no mic included in the PlayStation 3, but you can buy an external mic that you want. The PlayStation 4, there is a small mic included, so you can talk to your buddies over PlayStation Network, but you can also buy an external mic, something you want on your own, a third-party mic. The camera for the PlayStation 3, its resolution is 640 by 480 or 320 by 240. But the camera for the PlayStation 4 is 1280 by 800 or the resolutions that were similar to the PlayStation 3 as well. So basically it upscales. There's a higher resolution for the PlayStation 4 camera. The price for the PlayStation 3, new, you can get it for $200 depending on which hard drive you want. And then for the PlayStation 4, a new one will be $400, and there are more bundles, so you can get it for a little bit more than $400 with a game or with an extra controller and stuff. And release dates, obviously the PlayStation 3 is out now, and the PlayStation 4 comes out in like 35 days on November 15th, 2013. Basically what I'm saying is the PlayStation 4 is better in every way, shape, and form than the PlayStation 3. It's going to kick his ass, and I recommend you go pre-order it if you want a better PlayStation 3, because this is going to be way better. So stick with it. All right.
On the PlayStation 4, will you be able to play the popular titles from the PlayStation 3?
Good question. And at this moment, there are not going to be any... you cannot play the disc, so it's not backwards compatible. You cannot put in The Last of Us and play it on PlayStation 4. But next year, they're going to be starting Gaikai streaming, which that's what is expected, is that all of the PlayStation 3 titles are going to be able to be streamed to your PlayStation 4, kind of like Netflix is streaming movies to any device right now. And so that's what they're expecting, is that all PlayStation 3 titles can be played once the streaming service comes up. And they'll probably put them all for download on PlayStation 4 also, so you can download them off PlayStation Network. But yeah, does that answer your question?
Yeah, it does.
Brendan, do you have any questions about the PlayStation 4?
No.
I'm pretty sure I'm an expert in almost every way, except for everything I don't know.
I am the least educated person on the planet in terms of everything you just talked about.
Everything?
Yes, everything.
Okay.
I'm learning about everything you just talked about.
Yeah. Well, like I said, I recommend everybody get one. I love the PlayStation, and I'm going to get a PlayStation 4. I already have it paid for, pre-ordered, and I think it's going to beat the Xbox One. So.
When are you getting yours?
I'm getting mine the night it's released.
Yeah,
okay. I'm going to go to the midnight release on November 15th. I'm going with my buddy. We're going to sit in GameStop's line, and we're going to wait for it.
Oh, yeah. I did that for Grand Theft Auto V. It's a good time.
Yeah, it is. I've done it for Skyrim, NCAA Football, Assassin's Creed 3. I've done it for a lot of games. It's fun. Yeah.
Never done it.
It's a good time.
Get to go with other nerds who like the same thing you like. And so you just all get to talk about it and like yell and do cheers and rage and stuff. It's like it's like going to a sports game with all like-minded people that are all cheering for the game, for the sports game, but instead they're all cheering for a really nerdy game.
But then there's always that like one like parent that's with their kid.
Well, it depends on where you go. Like, because for Grand Theft Auto V, there weren't any parents.
That's how the GameStops are around my city.
Teenagers who wanted to play Grand Theft Auto. So, like, yeah. Except for that one person who's like, Grand Theft Auto 4 will never be beaten.
We're already at, like, 50 minutes or something like that. That's crazy. Oh. Which, that's okay. We can keep rolling. This will just be a little bit longer than usual. Okay, let's move on to listener questions.
Okay.
First one is from Steven on our email. Does anybody want to read it? You want me to?
I'll read it. What would you consider your proudest gaming accomplishment? For me, it's probably finishing Call of Duty World at War on Veteran. If that game is to be believed, the Axis spent their entire war budget on grenades.
Have you guys played World at War?
Yeah.
I've heard about it. I played World at War And although I've heard on Venom, they actually spawn grenades, like, near
Yeah, it's like you hide behind something, and it's just grenade after grenade after grenade rolling by you. It's just blowing up. Doesn't give you a chance to leave. So that's retarded. But anyways, all right. So, guys, answer this question. What do you think? What's your favorite, or what's your best, your proudest gaming accomplishment?
Okay, well,
you think on it?
Mine is getting 100% sync on Assassin's Creed 2.
Nice.
So it took me a very long time, and I'm very proud
That's
of that.
That's actually a good one. I didn't think of that.
Mine would probably be 1,000 pointing, like, my first game.
Gamerscore?
Yeah, Skyrim. And I didn't buy any of the DLC because I'm cheap.
So you got all the all the achievements for the original game?
Yeah.
Wow, nice. Do you have any?
I don't really have a, like,
proud moment.
Like, honestly, like, I don't know why, I can't really say there's anyone, like, pointing out at me. I know it's, like, a shitty answer, but...
No, it's each of their own. I had to think on it. I wrote my stuff down, so I'm prepared ahead of time, guys. I'm cheating. But, mine's very similar to Brendan's. Getting some of my 7 platinum trophies on PlayStation, which is like getting 1,000 gamer score on a game. And my first one was Final Fantasy 13-2. When I got that last summer, I was like so proud of myself. I was like, I finally have a platinum! Oh, yes! And then like 2 weeks later, I got Assassin's Creed Revelations platinum. And I was like, I have 2 platinums! And then last December, I got God of War 1 and 2. Those ones I didn't really get excited about because they weren't very hard. Naruto Ultimate Ninja Storm 3, I was pretty stoked about. I was cheering for that one because that one just happened this summer. And then The Walking Dead, which is easy because you just have to play through the game and you'll get all the trophies. But yeah. All right. Somebody want to read question number 2? It's from Bobby on our Facebook. All right, I'll read it. It says, what is your favorite video game soundtrack? Anybody have any?
That's hard.
Yeah, like I said, I wrote my answers down ahead of time. I was prepared.
Yeah,
I'll go ahead and answer first, since you guys can think. Or let you guys think. Mine would have to be... It's a 3-way tie, honestly. Between Tales of Graces F, Tales of Exilia, and White Knight Chronicles. And the thing they all have in common is they're all JRPGs. I love the soundtracks in JRPGs. They are freaking beautiful music. Mm-hmm. And it's all instrumental. There's, like, no voices. It's just... It's so amazing. But yeah, so one of those would have to be mine.
This is hard, and I mean, I almost want to say Zelda, and it's like a super cliche answer, but like Zelda really does do a good job of like scoring their music to,
which
like,
one?
The emotion.
All of them, or
all of them in general? Like their composing is always really, really well done. Like from like a musical standpoint, like if you treat video game soundtrack as like a score for a film, right? It's the exact same thing. Like it's supposed to convey an emotion from the scene. And I think that Zelda does that really well. But honestly, though, I'm gonna have to go with Dark Souls on this one.
Dark Souls, really?
Dark Souls music. Wow. It's kind of like in that sense, but it's much more like dreadful and like intimidating. Like there's one song that plays like in Ash Lake, which is like the bottom of the like world essentially.
Mm-hmm.
And you just go down there and like this like haunting like just chorus like vocal line just plays in like really brief intervals, and it was really cool.
I really wish if we had copyright or we didn't have copyright issues, we could insert like little bits and pieces of each of the songs we want to put in so everybody could hear them, because there's kick-ass songs that would do. But, Brendan or Jess, you guys have any?
Mine would probably have to be between, like, Ocarina of Time, just because, like, I still go back and listen to it, or Uncharted 3.
Ooh, yeah, that was a good one.
Like, Nate's theme,
mm-hmm.
I listened to that, like, most days during the summer until I finally burnt myself out. It is, like, one of my favorite songs from a video game ever.
To the same point, which when you said Ocarina of Time, is it the kind of thing where you'd play it and then you'd go to sleep and you would hear the song still playing in your head?
Cause,
because like I would back in the day when I would play the original Pokemon games, I'd play them so much with my friends and my little brother, and then we'd go to bed, you know, and like I still hear the music playing. Why am I hearing this? And it was so funny. Anyway, sorry. Go on, Jess. What you have a answer for this?
It's not really like a favorite thing, because I am like one of those nerds that loves music in games, just because it adds to the gaming experience a lot. So I like, it's kind of different ends of the spectrum. I like Assassin's Creed soundtracks because they're really good. And then I like DMC.
Devil May Cry.
Devil May Cry.
The remake?
Because, I don't know, it's just really angry music.
Oh,
like,
yeah, it is.
Because
that whole game is,
yeah,
like, psychotic,
yeah,
shit,
yeah, yeah,
happening,
yeah,
everywhere.
I don't know why. I just like it. It's just, I don't know.
Cool. All right. Brendan, ask question number 3. Or C.
Do you guys think the release of the next-gen consoles will stop people from playing GTA 5?
Hold on. That question's from Austin on our website. Go on.
I think that people will stop playing GTA 5, but I don't think that'll be just because the next-gen consoles are released. Like, obviously, like, anything that's, like, really new and, like, big will take away viewership, but, like, or, like, playership, I guess. But, like, I don't... I think it's just going to slowly slow down like any online game.
Yeah. What about you, Jess?
Yeah, I'm along the lines of Nate. I think eventually people will stop playing it, but I don't think the next-gen consoles will do anything because they're so expensive. Like, because
yep.
they're expensive, so not everyone's going to go out and buy an Xbox One and PlayStation 4, so...
Okay. Like, there will always be diehards, but
yeah.
for the most
yeah.
part, people move on.
I tend to agree with you guys. I don't think it will initially, because my main reason is because there's going to be limited copies of next-gen consoles,
yeah.
and, like... Grand Theft Auto sold over 13 million in the first day, and there's going to be significantly less. There's only going to be like a million or two at most of both next-gen consoles during the first month or so, and so that leaves another 12 million people who don't have next-gen consoles who still have Grand Theft Auto. So, like, initially it's probably not going to make much of a difference, but eventually it's just going to completely taper off and they're going to move on, because everybody moves on from games unless you're like 12 years old and that's all you play. Nate, go ahead and read us Jessica's question from Facebook.
Is anybody getting the new Pokemon? And what is everyone's favorite Pokemon?
Okay, first of all, we answered the favorite Pokemon question on episode 2. So if you guys want to hear that, go back and listen to that. Alright, so anybody getting the new Pokemon?
I don't have a 3DS.
Yeah,
otherwise I would.
Neither do I.
None of us do. Okay, so here's a better answer. I would love to get the new Pokemon, but I don't have a 3DS, or else I would. It looks awesome.
Yeah, I would buy it, but I would have to buy, you know, another, like, device
yep.
to play it.
Yeah, exactly. I would have to buy a 3DS just to play it.
And that would be the only game I'd play on it, probably.
Yeah, exactly. I wouldn't get anything else. My plan has always been that if Digimon redigitize, decode, or whatever, gets localized... then I'm going to get a 3DS. And so if that happens, then I'm going to get Pokemon X or Y, one or the other, because those two games are awesome.
I wish Nintendo would just start, like, publishing their games on different platforms, like, instead of making their own consoles.
Wait, sorry, what?
I wish, like, or not platforms. I wish Nintendo, like, they should stop making, like, terrible consoles and just release
hardware.
Their games for...
Just release software.
Yeah. like... like
that's a whole nother topic.
I like Nintendo's, like, business strategy in terms of, like, being, like, family-oriented and just... Because, you know, they were originally, like, a toy manufacturer.
Yes.
They made, like, hardware. And so I think that, honestly, like, they're too locked up on that mindset of treating it as, like, a toy.
But
and they need to
yeah,
move on.
I totally agree. And, like I said, this is a whole nother topic we can talk about another time, which also this is what I'm about to bring up as well. Is when you're talking about how they're a toy and everything like that, is that the original PlayStation, did you know it was supposed to be Nintendo? It was Sony was developing hardware for Nintendo as their disk drive for their next console, and they wanted rights to it, and Nintendo didn't want to give Sony rights to the disk hardware, and so they ended up backing out, and then that's when Sony made the PlayStation to, you know, to kick Nintendo's ass, and Nintendo went with a cartridge base to make the Nintendo 64. So yeah, they fucked up. That's the beginning of the fucking up. Going
well,
with cartridges.
Nintendo 64 is pretty cool.
Well, it was good, but it didn't have a lot of games.
True.
Credit to the Nintendo Wii U, though. Apparently, it's supposed like Watch Dogs is supposed to be better on the Nintendo Wii U
oh, really?
Than it is on the current gen consoles.
Yeah, there are like certain like gimmicks, like puzzle things you can do.
Yeah, because the second device or whatever, right? Like
mm-hmm. yeah.
how you can use touchpad and stuff for all the other devices for that game, but you can use the gamepad or whatever for Nintendo
yeah.
or Wii U at least.
Well, Nintendo's also really good about like offering their games for digital download, aren't they?
Yes, yeah, a lot of their old games. But they weren't originally, even though they advertised it. A lot of their games weren't on Nintendo Direct or whatever the hell it's called. Also, while we're on Nintendo, I heard that Assassin's Creed 4's DLC is not going to go to the Wii U.
Yeah, no.
So that's another Ubisoft thing, but yet it's also the reverse end. You know, Watch Dogs may be better for some things, but Assassin's Creed is going to be worse because it's not going to get DLC. but whatever. Anyway, so we all want Pokemon, it sounds like, but we all can't get it because we don't have a 3DS. Moving on. Next question is from JP on Facebook. And he says, or he asks, are there any PlayStation 4 JRPGs that you are looking forward to and why, or just RPGs in general? Now, I guess this can go to Xbox One also and PlayStation 4, so it doesn't have to be just directed towards that. But I think he was directing that one specifically towards me when I asked him. But if I had to answer this, JRPG-wise, there's not a lot of announcements right now for next gen. There are a few, and they are on my list, and those include Final Fantasy 15 and Kingdom Hearts 3. So,
this is going to be a great chance for me to like hype up Dark Souls 2 like a solid like minute. I am so pumped for that game. It looks amazing. I am slightly scared that they're going to dumb down the combat to make it more accessible to people, because right now it's like Namco's like best-selling like title in the current market, strangely. But
Namco's doing good.
Yeah, mainly because of Dark Souls, which is the funny thing.
Namco's doing well.
Namco's also doing well because of Ni No Kuni. And
yeah, that's true.
Tales of Exilia did way better than it was supposed to. So both of those games have been... Now, obviously, they're not as big as Dark Souls. Dark Souls is a major, major title.
But yeah, so like it's just... When the game gets more popular and you're kind of trying to spread it to a broader audience, you kind of don't want to piss off the niche market that was there in the first place. Is it niche or niche?
It's niche.
Okay, niche. You don't want to piss off the niche market that was there in the first place. Because, like, I like Dark Souls, like, combat, so
it was,
I don't want
it to hard. I heard it was hard, which is why I've never even taken the time to try it.
It's unforgiving, but, like, once you get the hang of it, it becomes a lot easier. It really is, like, a skill curve thing.
Have you guys heard of any RPGs or JRPGs for next gen that you're really excited about?
No.
I have not heard of any.
Unfortunately.
Yeah, you guys aren't as studied on it yet.
I'm not, like, yeah.
Go on.
Nate? Wasteland 2 is also coming out for the
really?
PC. That's cool. I've donated on the Kickstarter. It's by the guy who made Fallout 1 and 2.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I think I heard about that.
And then he is making another game that's a sequel to the game that inspired Fallout 1 and 2.
Okay.
So, and also, none of you guys have probably heard of Planescape Torment, but the guy who made that is also making another game that's like an isometric RPG.
Okay.
And it's on Kickstarter as well, and it's coming out soon.
Not JRPG-wise, but he also, since he mentioned RPGs, I'm also really, really excited for Dragon Age Inquisition.
Yes.
And The Witcher 3.
That.
Both of those games.
Cool.
Oh, my God. The Witcher 3 is my most anticipated game on next gen. So, like, there is nothing that stands close. There are a lot of games that look awesome, but The Witcher 3 looks way better than anything I've seen.
I've wanted to play The Witcher 2 more, but it just does not run well on PC.
Yeah, it doesn't really run well on Xbox 360 either, but I fought through it, so because I wanted to play it so bad.
There's a lot of optimization problems. Mm. It's just not graphically coded very well.
Okay.
Like, it's pretty if you have hardware to spare, but...
Now, I don't know if this is even an RPG or... Yeah, I think it's an action RPG. It's worth mentioning. I just heard yesterday, I think the Kickstarter went up yesterday, from a couple of guys who were at IGN several years ago. It's a ninja steampunk game. It's like a cyborg ninja or whatever in a steampunk world or whatever. So it's like Tokyo in steampunk version and stuff like that. And so I watched this like 5-minute video yesterday. It's on their Kickstarter page and it looks really, really cool. And I can't remember the name of the game for the life of me. But if I remember it, I'll mention it next week, so that everybody can go check it out. It's on Kickstarter for another 30 days, but it looks pretty cool. All right, let's move on to the last question. Anybody want to read it? You want me to read it?
Read it?
Okay.
It sounds really seductive.
I'll read it. It's from Vanessa on Facebook. I like a gamer guy, so what's a game, old or new, that would be fun for us to play together? You guys have any recommendations? For Castle Crashers? What's that?
It's like a... It was recently, like, 2007. It's kind of old at this point. But it's, like, a beat-em-up style game where, like, you're, like, a knight and you just, like, run through town and, like, kill bad guys. It's really fun. It's co-op.
Okay.
You can do it for people.
Okay. But, you think it would be cool for a girlfriend and guy friend?
Honestly, like, real advice, like, you should just be yourself. Like, it's really, like, shitty and, like, cliched advice, but, like, don't want to... Like, the guy's not going to like you if you're, like, just being, like, some sort of, like, fake.
But what if she wants to... What if she just wants to indulge in his passion with him?
I mean, I guess if you just want to be objectified and have, like, hot, sloppy sex and, like, go for it. But, like, if you want to have, like, a meaningful relationship, I'd just say be yourself and admit that you're not, like, too keen on video games, but ask him
what he likes. What if he asked her? What if he's like, hey, yo, Vanessa, you want to play some games with me? And she's like, okay. What if that happens?
Then I'm just
play
like
Pong.
Just admit that Pong, you don't know.
Yes.
Oh, that's the
is that best your is that your recommendation? Pong.
Yeah.
Yeah. Brendan. Brendan's all for Catherine. The Pong. Brendan. Catherine. That's a great one. Yeah. Let's go have a play a game all about cheating on your girlfriend with a girl with the same name.
Is that really what Catherine's about?
Yeah.
I had no idea really what it's about.
It's an awesome storyline, and the gameplay is all puzzles. And it's so hard. So, like, if you're into puzzle games, that's one to do.
So what you're saying is they should play Dead or Alive, like, beach party.
Yes, yes. Girls in bikinis playing volleyball. I'm down with that. Jess, do you have any recommendations coming from a girl? What would be a game that a girl would play with a guy?
If you're already skilled at get video games, like just a little at like first person shooters, I would just say whip out like an FPS whip out Call of Duty and just like kick his ass, kill him millions of times, and that'll show him how badass you are.
Okay, I thought this one out a little bit, or I tried to, and just fun games, obviously, and these can be older versions. Super Smash Bros. That could be a fun game to play with.
Yeah,
that's awesome.
Play Super Smash Bros.
Play the old Super Mario games. Those would be fun because you could be Luigi and Mario. Play games, PlayStation All-Stars, which is like Super Smash Bros., but it's a PlayStation. It's not nearly as good, but it's a game if you have PlayStation.
Play Pokemon and trade the Pokemon.
Yeah, there you go. That's
like,
not a lot of
gameplay. Gold and silver.
Yeah, and trade Lugia for Ho. What?
Portal 2.
Portal 2.
It's a great co-op game.
That's really fun as well.
One of the Borderlands games, you can play those co-op, and those are fun. Just go around shooting shit. Or Rock Band. Rock Band or Guitar Hero. You can play as a band.
Guitar Hero.
You
know,
those
play
games
that.
Are fun, too.
Just
you can definitely play that with
that.
A girl.
Yeah.
Or your boyfriend. Sorry, in that case. But, all right. That wraps up our question. Oh, wait. I got one more question. It just came in on text message about an hour ago. It says, what's your guys' favorite pizza?
Jalapeno pepperoni.
Oh, yeah.
We covered that one already.
Meat Lovers for Brendan? Ooh. I somehow saw that coming.
Okay, really?
Just kidding, dude. Go ahead, Jess.
Brendan likes hot meat.
Brendan likes our hot meat everywhere. we're kidding, Brendan. We love you.
Jess, what's your favorite pizza?
Probably be pepperoni, mushroom, jalapeno, and bacon all together
bacon.
In one slice
bacon!
Of pizza.
I can only sympathize with that bacon part.
Okay.
All right, you like meat. Got it.
See, pizza's like... When you get too many toppings on it, I feel like it ruins the taste of the pizza.
No. Yeah, it can.
Like,
yeah.
The Meat Lovers, it's like a bell curve of how much meat I can want before it starts to get bad. You know what I mean? Like, 3 is probably, like, my maximum.
Have you guys had Papa Kino's?
Nope, I haven't. I want to.
Have you guys ever heard
that
of this place called Pizza
outing.
Hut?
No. Really? Where?
Yeah,
where
it's this, like, little pizza place that started out in Wichita, and I guess it's pretty big now.
Pizza Hut's so overpriced,
it is,
though. Like, I can get a 214-inch special from Pizza Shuttle.
Mm-hmm.
That's like the same price as getting like one large pizza from Pizza Hut with delivery.
Or you get like a large pizza from like Little Caesars for $5.
Yeah, but they're like
Little Caesars.
Oh yeah, it's they dip it in grease.
Oh, guys, we're going over an hour.
Oh,
start
edit this out.
My answer would be either pepperoni or Meat Lovers. That's right, Brendan. Pound it.
Maybe we can share some meat.
Okay, now. All right, next session question thingamagoo. What are you guys playing right now?
Final Fantasy VI.
Yeah, you already said that. That's cool.
Working on Lost Odyssey still.
Lost Odyssey still?
Still Final Fantasy.
Still Final Fantasy XIII?
I'm done Grand Theft Auto. I'm playing Grand Theft Auto Online, but mostly Final Fantasy.
Cool. I am playing Beyond Two Souls, and I'm going to have a review up hopefully this weekend. So you should already see it, or you will early next week. Are you guys going to review the games you're playing, or are you going to not? I mean, it's no big deal. You don't have to, but are you guys going to review those?
Yes. See, I want to review Grand Theft Auto 5, but I don't know how I would.
Okay.
Because, like, there's so many
I could review
aspects.
Grand Theft Auto.
So you're also playing it. Would you rather,
I beat it now.
You can review it all you want. Yeah, cool.
It shouldn't be in the podcast, but it's a conversational podcast, so whatever. Be looking out for some reviews. I plan to review some of the older games I've played soon, too.
I haven't actually done one yet, so I might as well.
Yeah.
You guys, I've been kind of slacking.
While we're on the topic, did you guys see the new review page I had up there with the index for all
of
our
reviews? Yeah, I checked that out.
So that's where all of our index, or that's where all of the links are going to go. So everybody, go check out the new review page. You can find all of our reviews there. All right. Video game releases next week, which is this week for you guys who are listening. What came out on Xbox, Jess?
Skylanders Swap Force, Wipeout Create? Is that, yeah, okay. I think that Create has to do with the TV. Create and Crash. Yeah, it has to do with the TV show, right?
I think so.
Yeah.
Okay, I want to talk about the two PC releases real quick, because I actually know both of these pretty personally. Worms. If you guys haven't played Worms, that's like a classic.
The worm with the everybody's
stuff. Yeah, that is a classic video game. If you haven't played Worms, you should go, like, download Worms and play it.
Yeah.
Also, the Stanley Parable. So I remember playing this when it was just like a Half-Life 2 mod.
Sorry, hey, tell them what the game is called.
The Stanley Parable.
Okay, sorry, go on.
Oh, okay. So, like, I remember playing this back when it was just, like, a Half-Life 2 mod. Like, I also played the DRS that before it became, like, a real game. And, like, it's actually, like, this, like, really funny, like artistic critique look at, like, how video games work psychologically. And, like, it's just kind of, like, poking fun at, like, narrative and stuff. And it's really cool. And so I didn't know they were making an HD remix, but, like, definitely check it out. It's really funny.
Cool. On PS3, only Skylanders Swap Force comes out. So you can only find that one. And, Brendan, what came out on Wii U and 3DS this week, or next week?
Not surprisingly, Skylanders Swap Force came out in both.
Yep.
And both get Wipeout, Create, and Crash.
So next week is an exciting week for every device other than PC, which is all sarcastic, means only PC has exciting games.
Yeah, basically. So
go buy some PC games, guys. All right. And that wraps up the show, so let's do housekeeping. We record our podcast every Thursday or Friday, and you could find it on Monday, which we are actually thinking about switching up the schedule. So if we do, you will hear from us on all of our social media places and on the website. We, as usual, ask you guys for any suggestions on segments or topics you would like us to talk about, something that one of us can talk about next week on the podcast. Jess, where can they find us?
You can search for us on Facebook with Mong. Just search Mong, you'll find it. And then our Twitter handle is Mong Podcast. So yeah, check us out.
And you can check out our website at http://www.middleofnowheregaming.com, where you can find all of our latest blogs and episodes of the podcast and reviews and any other opinion pieces we put up. You can also find the podcast on iTunes now. And if you want to follow any of us, you can find us on Twitter or Facebook. But you can find me on Twitter at Osborne_2009. You can find Jess at
Jess Jayhawk.
You can find Brendan at
Brendan Jester.
And you could find Nate at
just find me on Facebook.
Just find him on Facebook. You can find all of us on Facebook by searching our name. Anyways, thank you guys for listening to episode 4, and we will talk to you again on episode 5.